Everyone, on this day of post 74th independence and the pre Ganesha Chatur festival, I welcome you all to this 10th AOI lecture series. And today we have two eminent speakers from the two prestigious institutes of India as well as worldwide. And to this day, we have the two moderators. The first speaker will be Dr. Kapil, and that session will be moderated by Dr. Sambhaji Govind Chintali, and he works as an associate professor in JUS Badnapur District Medical College, which is attached to Nashik University, and is also the director of Cosmo ENT Super Speciality Hospital. He is an invited speaker in various national and regional conferences, as well as he has to his further publications in national and international journals. I hand over this platform to Dr. Sambhaji to continue the session. Dr. Sambhaji, over to you.
Hello. Good evening for all the respected teachers and dear participants. I would like to introduce the Dr. Kapil Sikka sir, who is an eminent ENT surgeon and additional professor ENT and head neck surgery department AIIMS New Delhi. Sir is having as a faculty experience of 9 years. Sir have published more than 90 publications in national and international journals and over 100 presentations in various reputed meetings. Sir's special interest is otology and neuro-otology and head neck surgery, and sir has done a lot of surgeries. So I would like to call on Dr. Kapil Sikka sir to give their lecture.
Thank you, sir, for such nice and kind words. And thank you, Samir sir. Thank you, Bharti ma'am, for having me here. It's a really reputed platform, probably the biggest platform that one can get in our country. The great series, great weekly lecture series by AOI. It's a great initiative in these tough times. I think it's a good quality education being imparted on really good topics. And my post, Dr. Achal, I am looking forward to hear him, and they are really great topics. So I'll just try to do justice in the topic that has been allotted to me. The topic that we discussed mutually was diseases of external ear. External ear diseases can be a vast armamentarium. They can include atresias, they can include ear canal stenosis. So we decided that we should exclude them for time being from this presentation, and I'll focus my talk on external ear infections and some discussion on external ear tumors. My talk would be specifically focused on the malignancies of external ear. I sincerely acknowledge the contribution of my senior colleague, Professor Alok Thakkar. So if we look at external ear diseases, at times we very frequently ignore the importance of them. But as I was looking and running through literature pertaining to external ear diseases, I was surprised to find that American Academy of Otolaryngology Head Neck Surgery even has guidelines on how to manage ear bags. And probably these are very ignored topics in our practice, but they are important topics. We'll come on to the importance as I go through my slides and presentation. If you talk about external ear, then external ear is essentially an extension of the skin of pinna. So external ear diseases are not arising from anywhere else, but they are essentially the conditions that involve skin, or they involve the bone of external auditory canal, or very rarely the cartilage of external auditory canal. So this is not a rare presentation where some ENT colleague has harvested a cartilage from concha or from dragon, and it leads to some degree of perichondritis or cellulitis in this region that can extend to external auditory canal, leading to otitis externa. So this picture clearly shows the communication between the external auditory canal and the pinna, and these conditions can distinctly overlap. My first slide, probably related to the current discussion, is the external otitis. External otitis, for our junior colleagues who are listening to my presentation, is that it is predominantly of two types. It can be a localized otitis externa, which is more or less the boil that occurs anywhere else in the body. This is a hair follicle infection. The characteristic of this infection is that it's exquisitely painful. It's in fact one of the most painful conditions known to humankind. The patient will generally present with very severe pain, and it is very difficult to even examine the ear or manipulate the pinna in these particular conditions. They can also present to you with block sensation, and findings will depend on the disease stage. Once this boil ruptures, once it perforates, the pus will exude and the pain will dramatically be resolved. I wanted to stress on one point that external otitis, more predominantly the localized external otitis or furunculosis, can be at times confused with the mastoiditis, because this swelling can lead to lymph node enlargement more so in the post-auricular region, and patient may present as a condition that may mimic a mastoiditis to some extent. If the patient is presenting to you with recurrent furunculosis, then you need to work them up for some immune compromised condition like diabetes, or the patient might be a staphylococcal carrier. Management is fairly straightforward. If it's an abscess, you have to drain it, and there is some role for oral antibiotics, and of course it's a staph infection, so you have to cover a staphylococcus with oral antibiotics. And if it's a diffuse abscess or profuse cellulitis, then the patient might need IV antibiotics. I want to highlight the importance of pain relief in this particular conditions, and for rapid pain relief, if you pack the ear with the ichthamol glycerin soaked Vicks, then it's emollient, it absorbs the moisture, and it leads to very rapid control of edema and very rapid and good pain relief. So it's a very useful adjunct to treatment of this condition, and this is also a good antiseptic and anti-staph agent. Next condition that I wish to talk about is the benign necrotizing otitis externa. This is not same as the boil or furuncle as we discussed in the previous slide. The patients are not necessarily immune compromised, and the patient does not complain of severe pain, but pruritus or ear itching is the more predominant presenting feature. You have to differentiate it from a deep, boring, severe pain, because that is a sign or a symptom of underlying more serious condition, that is the scalpus osteomyelitis, which I'll be discussing in subsequent few slides. So that's the diagram. Most of the diagrams that and figures that I am showing are from the 7th edition of Scott Brown. Some of them are my own images, so I acknowledge duly the Scott Brown 7th edition. If you look at this slide, it very beautifully depicts the external auditory canal conditions, which I have discussed, and few I will prefer not to discuss in my presentation. This is the structure of normal EAC, normal external auditory canal, and normal deep lying tympanic membrane. That's your necrotizing localized external otitis, very commonly associated with the rigorous cleaning of ear and trauma to ear skin because of ear wick. There is no underlying bone damage. There is no bone expansion. It's only the skin excoriation. If there is extension into the bone and rapidly extending bony cavity, this is the condition called as the external canal cholecystoma. And if there is fusiform diffuse dilatation of external auditory canal bony enlargement, this is the condition known as keratosis obturans. Let us differentiate these conditions from diffuse otitis externa, a very common condition. 10% population will have it in lifetime. So one of the most common presentations with which the patient comes to us in OPD. Again, more or less symptomatology is the same. General edema and general erythema, itchy discomfort. The patient, they will initially come with pruritus, and later on it will progress to cause a diffuse severe otalgia. Otalgia occurs whenever there is secondary bacterial infection, and it's mostly Pseudomonas in most of the cases. So I would like to highlight that external otitis has a plethora of factors that can be contributing to one time as well as for recurrent pathologies. So there can be anatomical, where EAC can be narrow, it can be a keratosis, or hearing aid users, they very frequently get an otitis externa. Causes can be dermatological. Do not forget eczema and seborrheic dermatitis in such situations. We tell them not to clean their ears very frequently, because earbuds, they can be really traumatic to EAC skin and lead to recurrent external otitis. Humidity, we all know, it's more common in rainy season as well as in patients who are involved in water-related sports activities. And microbiological, as I already mentioned, more common organism is Pseudomonas aeruginosa. So that's the picture, how it looks like. There are some debris in the external auditory canal, mainly because of some shedding of skin and debris. The TM should be classically intact unless it is associated with the otitis media. The treatment more or less is same as the boils. It is limited to topical antibiotics, not oral antibiotics. If you can handle them with topical antibiotics, it works well. Hygroscopic agents as IG pack, it works here also. And oral toilet is probably one of the most common and ignored modality of treatments. You suck out these debris pack this canal with good hygroscopic agents and patients will get very rapid pain relief and they'll be thankful to you for life. Very interestingly, many treatments, they have not been compared. It's very difficult to compare which treatment is better, which antibiotic is better, or whatever works in your hands, I think it works. But I don't recommend to give a very high-end antibiotics for simple straightforward external rhinitis infections like this one. Otomycosis, again, this rainy season, it's fairly common condition. There are two types of fungi. I'll just give a photographic representation. If you see these black spores and black pigmented fungus there, it's more commonly because of Aspergillus flavus, and if it's pure white hairy growth inside, it's more commonly because of Candida albicans. Aspergillus is probably much more commoner than isolated Candida infection. You just need to suck out these debris and prescribe them topical antifungals. That will suffice in most cases. And of course, water sports and water entry is one of the leading factors. The patient has to be informed about these precautions. Next few slides, I'll be discussing about a more lethal and more dramatic condition of external ear that starts from external ear but can be a really life-threatening issue. That is skull-based osteomyelitis or malignant otitis externa. So where did this term come from? I think ear infections, they have been known for ages. Our ENT specialists, they have been working on them for ages together. But I found this article very interesting where James Chandler from Miami, Florida, he has first described this malignant external otitis. This is the actual snapshot from his actual paper, where he says that it's the purpose of this report is to describe the etiology, pathogenesis, diagnosis, and treatment of infection, which I have coined the phrase malignant external otitis. That's the first paper. It came in probably 1960s. So it is an aggressive, it is potentially lethal infection that involves ear canal and cranial base, and it's a very understood situation. I'll try to make some facts clear according to our practice here. First thing that comes to our mind while we talk about skull-based osteomyelitis is whether it is skull-based osteomyelitis or you are confusing it with some other more common pathologies. So it has a very typical clinical presentation. Patients present with otalgia. Otalgia is not severe or not outside the ear with the tragal tenderness or pain on movement of pinna as you see in the boil or furuncle, but they will present with deep boring headache type of pain. They also often have discharge, preauricular swelling, and facial nerve paralysis. If you are seeing one of these other symptoms apart from otalgia, then you have to suspect a skull-based osteomyelitis, and this condition leads to periostitis. Periostitis is, it's not only the inflammation of skin, but it's also the inflammation of periosteum, and that periosteum leads to spread of infection medially, where from it goes from tympanic bone to mastoid to petrous apex, and it can involve whole of skull base and even cross on to opposite side. So it's important that this is a periostitis apart from a cutaneous skin inflammation. Look at the pattern of granulation. It's very typical pattern of skull-based osteomyelitis. They start from floor of external auditory canal. Other areas might appear relatively normal, but they will appear at floor of external auditory canal, and then you will have a variable pattern of spread to other areas. Do not look at this disease in isolation. Never look at this disease that this is a skull-based osteomyelitis. I'm treating this skull-based osteomyelitis. These patients are diabetics, and probably, if I call it as lethal condition, more common cause for mortality is diabetes-related complications and treatment-related complications. Disease will probably not kill the patient for another 5 years, but your treatment can. So they are diabetics. They might have uncontrolled diabetics, and look at their chest x-ray, look at their kidney profile, look at their other systemic issues. Because it might be uncontrolled diabetes that may lead to lot more complications apart from this disease. And most commonly, more frequently, the patients will be male patients. If the patient comes to me, I will not rely more on investigations, but on my clinical suspicion, maintain a high degree of suspicion, and also very readily available inflammatory markers. TLC gives you some information. CRP gives you some information, and ESR, very important, prognostic as well as diagnostic indicator, elevated in 85% of cases in skull-based osteomyelitis. If you ask me one radiology, if you ask me that patient is affording, he can get all investigations, get both CT scan and MRI, because you need to differentiate it from other common malignant lesions like cancer of the ear. I'll discuss the cancer of the ear in subsequent slides. And you also have to differentiate it from more common nasopharyngeal carcinoma. So you get both CT scan and MRI. But if you ask me one investigation that is most useful, it is probably the CT scan, because it's a bony infection and CT scan gives excellent delineation of bony anatomy. Ideally, you don't need biopsy to diagnose skull-based osteomyelitis, because it will only suggest you that there is some inflammation or some granulation. But to rule out malignancy or if there is suspicion, biopsy should be performed, keep a low threshold. There is no harm in doing a biopsy for proving that it's only osteomyelitis and nothing else. So according to our experience that we have worked over the last few years, there are three patterns which are generally seen in skull-based osteomyelitis. So I have put a CT scan of all three patterns that we see. If you see this particular CT scan image, this is the permeative or erosive pattern. So this patient had, you can see the external auditory canal is surprisingly normal, in fact, on both sides. The mastoid is also normal on this side. This side was probably operated somewhere. And you can see how there is permeative erosion in medial temporal bone close to jugular foramen. It's also involving the petrous apex. So this erosive pattern is classically described as a hallmark of skull-based osteomyelitis. The patient may also have an abscess. Abscesses are not very well seen on a CT scan if you are mainly focusing on bony windows. But do focus on areas where you can see the temporomandibular joint. This widening of temporomandibular joint suggests that there is some degree of collection, which is most frequently pus. And these patients will have a surprisingly severe pains as compared to this group of patients. And third would be where you will have a lot of dead bone sitting there. Almost whole petrous temporal bone and even bone, anterior tympanic bone, EAC, anterior wall, and even the condyle of mandible, it has transformed into a dead sequestrum-like bone. So it will invite infection. There will be microabscesses sitting with this. This is the third pattern that we see. So erosive pattern, microabscesses or large abscesses, and third is the sequestrum, like this, the bony sequestrum, which is seen. That's the third pattern seen in skull-based osteomyelitis. Radiologic findings, more commonly the MR findings, they were described by Lesser et al. In Journal of Laryngology and Otology. You can see the differentiation on two sides. The good thing or the diagnostic point in skull-based osteomyelitis is moment you give contrast in a T1 weighted image, that the muscles and they will start to appear. You can see there is no differentiation between the lateral and medial pterygoid and the mucosa of fossa of Rosenmüller in this particular scenario. But as soon as you give contrast, the muscles, they will start to appear. What I want to highlight, another important fact is that you see the nasopharyngeal bulge in this region in this particular scan. This I have taken from this journal article. That's why it's important to differentiate it from a nasopharyngeal carcinoma. If you're not able to differentiate, it's better to take a biopsy from this area, exclude malignancy, and treat the patient as skull-based osteomyelitis. Another important investigation should be ideally, if I went through a Scott Brown publication, it mentioned gallium scan. Gallium scan is unfortunately not available at most settings. At our center, despite it being a large volume center, it's difficult to organize gallium scan because of its short half-life. So most frequently, we do a technetium scan. These are the differences between two types of technetium scan. This is the 2D planar and this is the SPECT 3D. The technetium images that are superimposed on the CT scan. So we have a publication that has come out from our institute, from the Department of Nuclear Medicine. They have, this obviously is a better investigation than this one, but this is more easy to get and more easy to interpret, and it's a fairly straightforward and cheap investigation compared to SPECT CT scan. But if you talk about diagnostic accuracy, then probably SPECT is a better modality. At our institute, we follow this staging. It's fairly straightforward. This has come from Professor Alok Thakkar's publication a few years back. It largely focuses on whether the disease is lateral to jugular foramen or it is medial to jugular foramen. We are working and we might publish over next few years the validation of this particular staging. But stage one is necrotizing external otitis. There is small skin erosion or superficial sequestrum of bony external or cartilaginous EAC. What is more common presentation is either stage two or stage three. Stage two is if the disease patient has skull-based osteomyelitis, but this disease is lateral to jugular foramen. There is bone exposure, there is sequestration, there is deep bony tenderness, there can be facial palsy, but disease is not involving jugular foramen. Why I am stressing on jugular foramen is because of cranial nerves. So if you want to clinically differentiate, if the patient is presenting to you with a 10th nerve or a 12th nerve or a 11th nerve paralysis, then there is obviously stage 3 disease that has extended medial to jugular foramen. And we can call it stage 3A, stage 3B accordingly if it is a unilateral or bilateral jugular foramen. So if you are prognosticating a patient, always see the involvement of jugular foramen. If the disease is lateral to it, you may call it stage 2 or early stage disease. If it's medial to it, if it's crossed the jugular foramen radiologically or clinically, you may call it a stage 3 disease. And obviously, it's a stage 3C if it's an intracranial infection that we'll talk about. Another important, if you ask my experience, it is difficult to culture bacteria because our transportation and everything, patient will come at night time, taking the swabs and sending it in a good environment is dicey in Indian scenarios. But if you grow a microorganism in these settings, you might need to go an extra effort to grow a microorganism because at times it's not seen in the external auditory canal skin. So you might have to do cultures from the middle ear. You might even have to perform a mastoidectomy or a meningotomy to take those cultures. But if you ask me, most common organism, it is PAX. PAX they call as Pseudomonas aeruginosa, that is ciprofloxacin sensitive. So fortunately, most common infections, almost 50% of times, you will find a Pseudomonas aeruginosa that is fortunately sensitive to most antibiotics. What is ignored is, and it's very emerging entity, is Aspergillus flavus. I'll tell you my experience, but it is also being increasingly seen more so in cases of central skull base osteomyelitis. Central skull base osteomyelitis is another entity where the usual signs of EAC involvement, lateral EAC involvement, are not there. It will start from jugular foramen, it's rapidly involved the clivus. So it is more so important to differentiate this from a nasopharyngeal carcinoma because they will present more like rhinogenic symptoms, symptoms of nasopharyngeal carcinoma, deep boring headache, nasal obstruction, and one of the cranial nerve paralysis. So diabetes is causative, but probably doesn't have a major impact on disease in this central skull base osteomyelitis, but it does have an impact in the lateral skull base osteomyelitis. What we do at our center is we start them on medical treatment. We give them multi-drug directed at Pseudomonas or culture directed. It's better if you can obtain cultures, well and good. If you cannot, start them on multi-drugs that are directed to Pseudomonas. So they are good choice of antibiotics. You can start piperacillin, tazobactam, ciprofloxacin, amikacin, natalmycin. But what I want to highlight is don't overdose, don't give shots and shots of amikacin because these patients can have some renal impairment or you can precipitate renal impairment and you have to adjust the dosages. If you have a physician or a nephrologist with you, adjust their dose to renal dosage. At times you might have to reduce the dosage to 1/4 of what a normal patient can tolerate. Does surgery have a role? It is very important question that has plagued clinicians for long time. If you search literature, you have got both viewpoints. There are viewpoints for surgery and there are viewpoints against surgery. I'll be just telling you what indications we follow for surgically operating these patients. Prognostic factors. Advanced age is a poor prognostic factor. If you are not able to control glucose or sugar levels well, it's a poor prognostic factor. Cranial nerves, if the disease is medial to jugular foramen, it's at advanced stage disease, it is a poor prognostic factor. Constantly elevated ESR is a prognostic indicator and a poor prognostic factor if it's not coming down. Technetium scan will take 9 months to come back to normal. But if you are doing a scan 9 months down the lane and it has come back to normal, that is probably a good prognostic sign. And clivus involvement, obviously, it's the most medial bone of skull base. If it is involved, it directly correlates with the cranial nerves. It directly correlates with the venous thrombosis and dural involvement, a very bad prognostic factor. Overall prognosis, I would not say that most patients die of skull base osteomyelitis, but will die of stroke, they will die of myocardial infarction and other complications related to diabetes. It is not I am not saying it's not a deadly disease, but overall 2-year survival in our series would be in range of 80-90% if you can handle these complications well. So these are the points that we follow for considering surgery in these patients. If the patient is having, maybe you have given antibiotics for 3-4 weeks and patient is still having a bad persisting pain. I had shown you one scan, I'll show you again a bony sequestra. Refractory cases, more or less overlapping indication as persisting pain. Deep infections that require biopsy. You may not at times feel that this can be something else. That is an indication for surgery. And if there is abscess anywhere in the body, it needs to come out, it needs to be drained. Another point for surgery. So I'll be presenting briefly our experience over last few years. 30 cases, age range was 40 to 78 years. Two males, only two females. It's a male predominant disease. So at my center, we had very few patients who had come with normal cranial nerves. 25 of them had some cranial nerve palsy at presentation, and 9 of these had more than one cranial nerve palsy. Of course, a bad prognostic indicator. 9 had facial nerve paralysis. We treated 13 patients only medically, no surgical treatment, and 17 by surgery. Surgery included meningotomy, mastoidectomy, or extensive debridements. 5 of these were pseudomonas. We could not grow any bacteria. Many of them were inconclusive. No bacteria grown or it was a contaminant. 2 were MSSA, Staph aureus. 2 cases had fungus and 1 had tuberculosis. So we had 18 satisfactory outcomes. 6 of our 30 patients had died and 6 had progressive disease till the time I last followed them up. So I'll be just presenting, for sake of case-based learning, 3 case scenarios. This patient had a bad diabetes, controlled by a lot of insulin, heavy dosage. He required multiple small procedures for DM-related issues in the past also. So this scan, we had done almost 1.5 year back right-sided radical debridement, and probably we obliterated this cavity by some tissue. It was fairly well healed. The patient did not have any pain on right side. But now the patient presented to us with left-sided severe otalgia and left-sided skull base osteomyelitis. You can see right side was fairly well healed. Patient did not have any complaints pertaining, but had crossed over to other side. Deep boring pain on left side. Right side was fairly well healed. So even technetium scan had shown reversal on this side, but if you go on to other side, there was a petrous epicytis and a lot of technetium uptake on other side. So since it was a very medial disease, patient was elderly, he had diabetes related comorbidities. So we planned no surgical intervention in this case. We chose the patient for a medical treatment. This patient had a temporal bone trauma, and subsequent to that, he had a lot of osteomyelitis in his temporal bone extending to petrous apex. He underwent a modified radical mastoidectomy elsewhere, and he had a recent 5th and 10th nerve palsy indicating a medial skull base osteomyelitis. Biopsy was this thing. It was aspergillus, lot of keratin flakes, occasional giant cells, septate hyphae, bony sequestrum, colonization by fungus elements, and that was the scan. A lot of infection in medial temporal bone and petrous apex. So that was the surgery we did. Moment you did external ear examination, there was a lot of debris in the EAC. We went post-oral, cleared the patient of all the debris, elevated the previously placed graft, debrided that graft, excised that graft completely, drilled the sounding bone so that we could get a better and wider exposure there. You see a lot of sequestrated bone underlying wherever it was eroding the labyrinth. It was extending right into the internal auditory meatus. You can see the facial nerve. Facial nerve was lying just floating in the mastoid. That was a vertical segment of facial nerve, and you can see the anterior labyrinth cochlea has been replaced by the sequestered bone. We could successfully take that out, do the entire petrous apicectomy from the transmastoid approach. And that was 1 year follow-up. The patient was absolutely pain-free. We did not obliterate the cavity. We grafted it. Now, we are really finding it difficult to manage his cavity-related problems, but we could salvage the patient in terms of his symptom-free. We could not salvage the facial nerve, but yes, he has comorbidities associated with other issues, but not the skull-based osteomyelitis. So that was sequestrated bone, almost whole temporal bone, post-trauma, replaced with the sequestrum, and that needed a surgical removal. Another patient, 65-year-old, diabetic, long-time diabetic. This patient also had diabetes-related complications, but his pain was not resolving with any of these antibiotics. He had a severe otalgia, TMJ pain, and as I told you, there was widening of one-sided temporomandibular joint. You can see on left side, and probably it was evident that there is some soft tissue adjoining the temporomandibular joint on left side. Mastoid was fairly normal, but panic membrane had evidence of disease. So again, we went post-oral. In this particular case, large post-oral incision. You can say, modification of fish type B approach. Elevation of periosteum of the mastoid. Our area of interest was not the mastoid, but anterior tympanic bone. We went there. We excised all the soft tissue anterior to tympanic bone, and exposed the, of course, we carefully identified the facial nerve and pushed it down, exposed the mandibular condyle. With a saw, we removed the mandibular condyle and drained that abscess there. So this patient had persistent pain, more in preauricular region, not controlled with antibiotics, required surgery for drainage of micro and macro abscesses. Main cause for mortality in this particular scenario is twofold. One, the patient can have a thrombophlebitis of some major sinus, or they can have a carotid thrombosis. Third most common cause is the lower cranial nerve palsy. The patients can badly aspirate, develop aspiration pneumonia, and that can prove potentially lethal. So what we employ at our institute, along with medialization thyroplasty, is the cricothyroid approximation, where you can medialize the vocal cord effectively, improves their voice, improves their swelling, and probably better outcomes in terms of long-term mortality. Take-home messages, it's a radiological diagnosis and clinical diagnosis. Treatment is medical with broad-spectrum antibiotics. If patients are not responding, they are having abscess or sequestrum, these patients will need surgery. Risk of surgery to be weighed with benefits. You cannot take a bad renal disease patient with three strokes or myocardial infarctions in the past for surgery, because that can itself prove risky. You need to accurately stage the disease, as I mentioned already, and lower cranial nerves are stage 3 and they are poor prognostic patients. Tumors of the temporal bone, this all of us have seen in some part of our practice, more associated with water entry, water sports. There can be bony outgrowths, can be multiple, all solitary, but this is a sessile swelling. You will see it originating from large circumference of external auditory canal. A very characteristic appearance of exostosis. No need to treat them if they are not causing any problems, but at times they can obstruct the EAC very badly, or they can lead to accumulation of keratin debris medial to it, leading to canal cholestetoma. So in those scenarios, you might need to drill them out. Otherwise, they generally don't need treatment. You can see the differentiation between these two scenarios, a more sessile appearance and more pedunculated appearance. Pedunculated, bony on feel, is classically an osteoma. If it is symptomatic, you can just amputate it and it does very well. Cancers of temporal bone, they are rare, but as any other body cancer, they are serious disease. They constitute 0.2% of all head and neck malignancies. So if you are seeing comparing them to buccal cancers or thyroid cancers or larynx cancer, they are fairly rare, and American estimates suggest they are around 1 to 6 per million population. So why it's been included here? Because external auditory canal is probably the most frequent tissue of origin, and histology is most frequently squamous cell carcinoma. Again, presentation is like presentation of patients with external otitis, scalbus osteomyelitis, or more importantly, CSOM. They have otalgia, they have otoria, they have hearing loss, they can have facial palsy, and they may present at times with parotid mass. Radiology is not diagnostic. I would not say you bank on radiology. I have shown you this image in my previous case discussion. Large sequestrated bone. It was not malignancy, but a aspergillus scalbus osteomyelitis. And surprisingly, this patient had a small mass, just came to us with the features of external otitis or a slight blockage and pruritus of EAC, very small mass in external auditory canal, biopsy was carcinoma. So radiology can be deceptive. This patient had just osteomyelitis, but only an infection. This patient with a small lesion in the EAC had external auditory canal squamous cell carcinoma. So common conditions obviously will remain common. It's a standard postgraduate teaching. If you have these symptoms, I will not say you suspect a temporal bone cancer, suspect a cholestetoma, suspect scalbus osteomyelitis. They are much more common. But if you have excluded them, suspect a cancer also. That is a cholestetoma. Large erosive mass. The patient had been operated by a mastoidectomy somewhere else. He came to us with a clinically discharging sinus in post-auricular region. The patient had a violated mastoid. Biopsy was unfortunately not sent. So the patient was planned for biopsy. But this is just to highlight that in case you are having any situation where you find that mastoid findings are atypical, there are a lot of granulations or there are friable mass, it is good idea not to presume this as inflammatory granulations. Always send them biopsy. Surprises are not rare. You may find an occasional tuberculosis or a malignancy in one of these scenarios. Workup should be again CT scan and MRI. They are both complementary to each other. I think there is no excuse of not doing an MRI in temporal bone carcinoma because it tells you the involvement of crucial structures like the sigmoid sinus or dura. Do a good metastatic workup. These are cancers. They can metastasize to lymph nodes and also distantly, and also include biopsy in your workup. Of course, you cannot prove a carcinoma without a biopsy. We at our center follow the modified Pittsburgh staging. It's a fairly comprehensive, good staging to follow. Tumor limited to external auditory canal is T1. If there is a full thickness bone erosion, partial thickness bone erosion, it's T2. Full thickness bone erosion, also the facial nerve, it is stage 3. That's the newer modification. And if the tumor is eroding the cochlea, petrous apex, medial wall of middle ear, carotid canal, jugular foramen, or extensive soft tissue involvement, it is considered as T4. If you ask me one treatment for temporal bone carcinoma, if the tumor is operable, if it's operable in your hands, if it's not operable in your hands, send to someone who has good experience in lateral skull base surgery. Surgery is the mainstay of treatment. So if you can operate, always operate. Most literature reviews had advocated surgical treatment over radiotherapy. It is the accepted standard. Only radiotherapy, there is hardly any literature, but there is some literature on chemo radiotherapy. There are largely three surgeries described for temporal bone carcinoma. The most commonly performed and most easy to perform, I will not say very easy, but most easy amongst these is the lateral temporal bone resection. I'll show you a video of lateral temporal bone resection where you try and en-bloc remove the external auditory canal bone, the tympanic bone, tympanic membrane, all the ossicles, leaving behind the stapes. Of course, you may have extensions of lateral temporal bone carcinoma to involve the parotid gland, the mandibular condyle, as well as you may include the significant mastoid ear cells, even extend posteriorly back till the sigmoid sinus. We all have read about sleeve resection, that is the en bloc sleeve removal of external auditory canal skin. Mind it, EAC carcinoma is a very strong propensity from going from skin to bone. So in our experience, as well as in literature experience, sleeve resection is not a good operation for EAC. Minimum operation for even T1 external auditory canal carcinoma is the lateral temporal bone resection. So that's how we do the lateral temporal bone resection. It's a large post-auricular incision. You elevate the anterior base flap, just as you do in mastoidectomy. You transect the external auditory canal, but at the time of transection, you have to be clear. You have to be sure that you are staying fairly lateral to your tumor. You don't have to be very close because you have to give them good margins. So connect your circumferential EAC incision with your post-oral incision and elevate this flap completely. So that's your EAC cuff of skin. This is your elevated skin. If you have to combine it with parotidectomy, which we do in most of the cases, then you have to elevate it off the parotid also. You elevate this superior based temporalis muscle flap and you do your cortical mastoidectomy and the posterior tympanotomy as you do in cochlear implants. If you have a nerve monitor, it's a good idea to stay close to facial nerve, monitor the facial nerve with the nerve monitor and extend your posterior tympanotomy down as you do in extended posterior tympanotomy. Thereafter, you elevate the parotid gland from your EAC cartilage and identify the extra temporal facial nerve here, intraparotid facial nerve. So you extend your incision circumferentially all around, and final cuts, they are better given with a gouge and hammer because it's very frustrating to use drill and complete the tumor excision. In this area, the temporal bone might be adherent to soft tissues in the periparotid region, which you need to dissect and cut off with some sharp instrument like the scissor in this case. If you have to include the parotid, do it with at this stage. That's the external auditory canal tumor. This is the EAC cuff. And that's the excised specimen of lateral temporal bone. So wound heals well. We do rotate time temporalis muscle to cover these defects. There is some degree of depression in this area, but prognosis in T1, T2 is excellent. If you go a step ahead, your excision will extend medial to facial nerve. initially the excision line was extending just lateral to your stapes, including the ossicles, that was the lateral temporal bone dissection. But if your excision is extending medial to facial nerve, it is the medial cut is going through the internal auditory canal and you have to include whole of labyrinth. This operation is known as a subtotal temporal bone dissection. It is applicable in this type of tumors which are involving the middle ear. So lateral temporal bone was for tumors that are limited to EAC, not breaching the tympanic membrane. If the tumors have breached the tympanic membrane, then you have to perform the operation called as the subtotal temporal bone dissection, where you have to associate your excision with craniotomy. You don't have to violate the dura here, but you have to do a craniotomy, elevate this bone up, do a complete mastoidectomy, or you can leave this. We can make this cut with Bugen hammer. Do a neck dissection. Tray your internal and carotid tree up. So final cuts should go. You notice the position of the osteotome. It is and your medial has to go the internal auditory canal to break hole of your cochlea, your vestibule, and expose the IAM medially. You have to sacrifice the facial nerve in this scenario. Muscle or the temporoparietal flap, you elevate it and penetrate this large cavity with this flap and place your craniotomy or temporal bone removed back. So that's the subtotal temporal bone resection. Total temporal bone resection extends till the petrous apex. So you can see this is the carotid artery, that's the petrous apex. If you have to do this operation, you end up violating the carotid artery. And in most textbook, if you follow papers from Grupo Otologico and Mario Sana's group, as well as our own experience, this operation is largely not recommended nowadays because it violates the carotid artery. If the tumor is so close to carotid artery, you deem it as inoperable and you employ other modalities of treatment. There are some controversies in temporal bone carcinoma also. Is total temporal bone resection justified? I've already talked about it. Their literature both for and against, but if you ask me nowadays case scenario, if the tumor is so extensive that you are needing a total temporal bone resection and sacrifice of carotid artery, you may probably handle it better with chemo radiotherapy or debulking surgery and handle it with radiotherapy. That is a better option rather than this advanced surgery. Should tumor removal be in toto? Yes, if possible. If you are doing a total lateral temporal bone resection, try to remove the tumor in one piece. But if it's not possible and you are doing a piecemeal resection, that is also acceptable if you can achieve negative margins. It's a good idea to send frozen sections from medially. So if you do a mastoidectomy, remove the tumor, go medial to tumor, again remove it piecemeal, that is also acceptable, but your margins should be negative. Should parotidectomy be performed? Nowadays, we are resorting to parotidectomy in all the cases, even in early stage temporal bone carcinoma. If you ask me, yes, it should be performed because there is evidence for it. Most important point here is that parotid is the first Echelon lymph node draining point from the external auditory canal. So it may harbor some lymph nodes even if it's not radiologically or clinically involved. If it's a T4 disease, then we would recommend a total parotidectomy. But T1 to T3, you can do a superficial parotidectomy. They may act as a good sampling procedure for you. Should we do neck dissection? If you are handling T1 and T2 cancers, there are no clinically overt neck nodes. You may avoid neck dissection, but if it's overt metastasis, then you have to include neck dissection. It's a good option to salvage because you are anyway working in the level 2 field. It is good idea to sample a few lymph nodes from level 2 and send them from histology, because if they are positive, then you may need to upstage your adjuvant treatment. Adjuvant treatment helpful. If it's a T1 or an early T2 carcinoma, no need for adjuvant treatment. You may treat the patient with single modality. But yes, if it's a T3 or T4 disease, you have to supplement your surgery with radiotherapy. If your margins were positive, you have to supplement it. Role of chemoradiotherapy is debated, although there is one paper that I came across, a meta-analysis, where they feel that CTRT, not only radiotherapy, they may have a reasonable outcome, almost comparable to surgery, but that's very anecdotal and only one paper-based data. You don't need to really reconstruct. You may reconstruct as a normal mastoidectomy if it's a small defect, or you may opt to close the external auditory canal, a blind sac closure for a small defect. If it's a large defect, if it's almost reaching 9 centimeters, then you may use some pedicle flap, as I had shown you. Maybe a temporalis muscle can be rotated and the wound can be closed. if it's a large defect, if it's you are amputating the pinna, or it's a large defect, your carotid artery is lying exposed, it's better to bring some vascularized tissue like a free flap from somewhere else. Roughly, if it's more than 9 cm, you will need a free flap. Prognosis directly depends on the stage. In next slide, I'll tell you my our experience also. If it's T1, T2, you may achieve almost 100% cure rates in a temporal bone carcinoma. So that's a univariate analysis of factors predicting outcome. Significant things you can say: facial palsy means advanced stage disease, a very important prognostic factor. Dural involvement, obviously, advanced disease, very important prognostic factor. Mastoid invasion, advanced disease, very important prognostic factor. That was published by our radiation oncology colleagues of 52 patients over last 10 years. Mean age was 56 years. Male dominated disease, 31 males, 12 females. We treated 16 of them with surgery, 14 of them with radiotherapy. And two highlighted poor prognostic factors. If it's a T3 stage, prognostically poor. Facial nerve palsy, prognostically very, very significantly poor. So temporal bone carcinoma, at the end of my talk, I would like to highlight it's a fair prognostic disease. It's not a bad prognostic disease. It's good to venture into aggressive surgical treatment. If you ask me mainstay of treatment, one treatment, it is definitely surgery. But if it's very advanced disease, you have to remove whole temporal bone, place carotid artery at risk, sensible option to resort to CTRT. Lateral temporal bone resection is the minimum operation. There is no role for sleeve resection, and combine it with parotidectomy. If there are positive margins, if there is dural involvement, if there is facial nerve involvement, that indicates a really bad prognosis. So with this, I end my talk on, I try to simplify as much as possible on temporal bone tumors and infections, and any questions or opinion from experts, I would like to welcome. Thank you so much.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Kapil sir, there are 2 to 3 questions for you, sir.
Yes, please.
Dr. Satyaprabha Phukan from Guwahati is asking for the Ichthamol is not available nowadays. Any commercial preparation for that Ichthamol?
It is available with us, sir. Achal sir, you are getting the question. I feel it is available. If it is not available, then maybe I will don't use it.
Okay.
So what is exactly the question? You are saying if it is not available, then you suggest an alternative.
Yes. Any commercial preparation, alternative commercial preparation?
It is very readily available in Delhi. We have abundantly available in our OPD setup. We just make the Vicks available. I'm not sure at other places. Achal Gulati sir, if he is hearing me, or other Bharti ma'am.
In this COVID era, can this condition be managed effectively without cleaning or instrumentation in the external canal, keratosis obturans?
Yes, keratosis obturans I did not cover in detail in my talk, but if I get a patient, I'll try to manage it non-operatively. In this COVID era, I will try to give good pain relief to the patient, manage and suction out all the debris as much as possible in daycare settings as much as possible. And avoid surgery. Yes, it can be managed conservatively if the patient is getting benefit.
Okay, and last one question is, sir, what are the complications may occur during the temporal bone carcinoma surgery, sir?
So complications are, as you do an advanced mastoid operation, you can get a transient facial paresis. It should not be permanent if you are doing a lateral temporal bone resection. You sacrifice facial nerve and you have to rehabilitate with alternate sources in doing a subtotal temporal bone resection. Carotid injury definitely is a potential danger. And if you are doing a subtotal temporal bone resection and your medial cut is going through the internal auditory canal, then you have a potential to get a CSF leak, meningitis, if your reconstruction is not good enough.
And lastly, sir, Dr. AP Shah from Patna is saying that it was an excellent presentation, sir. And all the questions are over, sir, now. And I congratulate, sir, for your great presentation, including all the external ear cases and temporal bone malignancies, sir. It was a very nice talk and excellent presentation, sir.
Thank you, sir. Achal Gulati, sir, is here. I want to ask him. I want to take his opinion on, sir, ectomol glycerin. What is your preference? Do you use it for ESC
infections? If I can get it, Kapil, there is nothing like that, you know, because the ethanol inside and glycerin is a hygroscopic substance and as an anti-inflammatory agent to absorb the moisture over there, yes, really yes. works wonders for a furuncle. It is available in Delhi, but very few shops give it. Number one, it's commercially unviable for them to sell such a cheap medicine at a very high cost. So, but if it is available, I think there's nothing like it.
And it's a good idea to put your pharmacists to work because they can, in our pharmacy laboratories, we used to make carminative mixtures, we used to make lotions and Mendel's throat paints and all these. They were very good medicines and good drugs. I think
a simple pack inside for a couple of days really helps it in clearing off the disease very fast.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Good point.
Excellent talk, Dr. Kapil.
Thank you, ma'am.
Your experience speaks it from the prestigious institute of the nation.
Yes,
now, ma'am. Kapil, you said some 5 antibiotics for skull-based osteomyelitis. All 5 you give?
No, ma'am. I will never give one
how
antibiotic.
How do you choose multiple antibiotics? How do you choose?
Yeah, ma'am. So, I'll never give one antibiotic. That is for sure. If the patient is presenting to you and you are giving one antibiotic, you are inviting resistance. So, my suggestion here is never give one antibiotic. That should be the norm. Most commonly, if the patient has come to me, I don't have time to get cultures. First thing that we'll do is send cultures. If you can get a culture, good culture directed antibiotic, that is the best. Otherwise, we would prefer a broad spectrum antibiotic coverage. Our treatment of choice here is piperacillin tazobactam, which comes with brand name Zosyn. And we also supplement it with one of the aminoglycosides if the patient has renal tolerance like amikacin. So my choice would be piperacillin tazobactam and amikacin if that is tolerable. And once we have achieved a good disease control, we can discharge the patient on oral macrolides like oral fluoroquinolones like ciprofloxacin.
Good disease control means what exactly? Like CRP coming to normal?
Yes, ma'am. CRP coming down. Maybe if the ESR was 100 and we have brought it down to 20. But there are patients, I think, according to our experience, pain control is the best parameter to decide your treatment rather than only ESR. So at times the ESR is 50 and patient has a good pain control. You can think at stepping down your antibiotics, but very, very cautiously.
Okay. And if like the CRP is normal, you discharge the patient and again patient comes back with a good diabetic.
We have to, ma'am, keep a very, very close follow-up. Your concern is very valid. There are patients who we discharge. After 3 weeks, they will have again severe pain and they will come back with elevated ESR. So we reinitiate our aggressive antibiotic and local debridement and local topical treatment protocol in that case. Yes, ma'am, it goes back to square one.
Yeah. And what is the role of PET MRI or PET CT in malignant rotitis externa?
Ma'am, we are mostly banking on the technetium. But yes, we have a small study going on currently. It is one of the candidates from nuclear medicine department who is working on the role of PET CT. I would say that role of PET in infections of skull base or complex ENT infections. Complex ENT infections, I would also include fungal infections, our sinus fungal infections and skull base osteomyelitis. I think we should explore more the role of PET CT scan in when to stop treatment because it's a very sensitive parameter to suggest inflammation or infection in a particular area. If a PET CT, you should get a pre-treatment PET CT and a post-treatment PET CT. If it is coming back to normal, it can be a good indicator of stopping treatment. So currently we are not using it as parameter, but it is experimental.
Thank you, Dr. Kapil. It was a good talk. And Kapil, on behalf of all of us, we wish your son a happy birthday.
Thank you.
I know you have to go for your son's
I'll stay back for some time. Vachal sir starts. So.
Enjoy the party.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. And now the next session will be by Dr. Achal Gulati. I think everyone in India remembers him as quiz master. He's known for his quiz mask. you know, we all remember you. So the way you conducted, I think the last 25 years I've seen you, and I enjoy your sessions of quiz, and it's amazing. And now for this session, the moderator is Dr. Nandu, and actually Nandu Kolwatkar, and you know, known as Nandu for all of us. Hi, Dr. Nandu. Is a consultant ENT surgeon from Nagpur. Is attached to Orange City Hospital. Is in charge dedicated cochlear implant program in Nagpur, and also is in charge of a dedicated COVID health center in Nagpur. And we all know how well he conducted our prestigious conference of our AYCon 2020. 2019, I think. 2020 only. We all enjoyed your hospitality and academic sessions, Nandu. And now over to you, Nandu.
Thank you, Bharati Madam, for those wonderful words. Who doesn't know Dr. Achal Gulati, sir? A legendary quiz master. Dr. Achal Gulati, former Additional Director General of Health Services, Government of India. After graduating from University of Delhi, did his post-graduation from prestigious PGI Chandigarh. After working at Maulana Azad Medical College for more than 30 years, he was instrumental in establishing the new medical college, the Dr. BSA Medical College, New Delhi, as a founder director principal. He was then entrusted with the responsibility of heading the Govind Vallabh Pant Institute of Postgraduate Medicine and Research, the premier flagship super speciality institute of Delhi government, and its director. Currently, he is professor of excellence at MAMSI, New Delhi, where he is looking after teaching, research and clinical activities. A recipient of many national and international awards. To name a few, National Eminent Teacher of Excellence Award by the Government of India, Dr. Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan National Award for Eminent Teacher. Many of him know him as a legendary quiz master, a keen and professional quiz master of national and international level, a food and travel critic writer. He has about more than 75 national and international academic publications, has contributed chapters in various textbooks. Along with that, he is a member of various professional academic bodies, like there the list is too much, but for example, he is presently the member of board of governors of the International Rhinoplastic Society, is the current president of the International Society of Rhinoplasty. He is the former president of All India Rhinology Society. Ladies and gentlemen, I present before you the legendary Dr. Achal Gulati, sir, to deliver his lecture on otitis media with effusion and CSI mucosal disease. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Nandu. You know, at these times, you come to know yourself at times. But thank you so much. I'll share my screen. Yeah. So to start with, when Sameer rang me up and told me to talk on otitis media with effusion and CSOM mucosal disease, it gave me a little bit of jitters. How do I start and finish these two talks? Because if today morning, just before this, when Kapil talked on otitis externa, disease of the external ear, tumors of the external ear. Am I audible?
Yeah, we can hear you, but rest, everybody, please mute. Yeah.
Okay. So with Kapil just finishing off the disease of the external ear and tumors and otitis media with effusion and CSOM mucosal disease, half of otology is covered in these 2 hours, thanks to Sameer. To come on to this topic of the otitis media with effusion to start with. This is a slide which I really love. You know, there are two parts to this slide. One is a house that Jack built. If you see, the house is built in three sections, the outer section, which is the larger one, the middle section and the inner section. Now, the larger outer section that you see actually is what Kapil covered, the pinna and the external otic canal, which is what the world sees as the most beautiful things, bearing solitaires and whatnot, one solitaire, two solitaires. Dr. Bharti would be a better judge. How many solitaires can you wear on the pinna? I really do not know. The middle part is the one which is the crucial functional part of our ear. That house is our ossicles, that houses our mid layer spaces, that houses our mucosal folds over there. And that is where we basically develop our hearing. So today, when we focus our attention on the mid layer part and the effusion part, the picture on the right side shows you a balloon with more balloons inside. Now that is representative. The outer balloon is representative of the mid layer with a space inside, and the balloons inside that is what we are going to talk about. That is the effusion part of it today. So when we talk about otitis media with effusion, what are we looking at? We are looking at many names: glue ear, secretory otitis media, serous otitis media, non-separative otitis media, eustachian tube catarrh. So you have so many things what we are looking at, and at the end of the day, what we have is basically fluid in the middle ear, and that is what otitis media with effusion is. But if I look at it as if it is, it is basically the symptoms which are there which help me to diagnose it. It is basically a non-purulent effusion what I'm talking at, and the type of effusion what I'm looking at is either a mucoid or a serous or maybe a hemorrhagic fluid inside. It is not acute otitis media. It is not acute otitis media because that is what is presenting with pain and maybe with discharge. Over here, I may not have pain, but I may not have discharge. I may have a little bit of pain, but basically if I look at acute otitis media, serous otitis media, chronic separative otitis media, they basically would be difficult to talk about as one discrete disease, but they are basically a part of the same spectrum of a disease, as we would see as we go along. So when we talk about otitis media with effusion versus other forms of mid-layer infection, what are we looking at? The mid-layer bone, the pneumatized spaces of the temporal bone are contiguous with each other. Keep that in mind. Now that is what imparts the basic fundamental of spread of disease as far as the ear disease is concerned, because all these spaces are contiguous. So it's difficult to restrain the infection in one particular area. To any disease process which is there in one area, once the middle partitions break off, they spread all over the ear. So if I look at otitis media, a generic term defined as an inflammation of the middle ear with relation to a specific etiology or a pathogenesis. So it's a generic term. Now, with this otitis media, it is basically again a continuum of related diseases of the contiguous structures which are there. So the perilabyrinthine cells and the petrous apex, the mastoid, all these form one contiguous area, and the any disease process in that, inflammatory process in that, would result in otitis media. So if we look at, whether we look at acute otitis media, recurrent otitis media, acute otitis media with effusion, they are part of the same rainbow as we get across. So when we look at what, how does it go about, the males are probably a little bit more affected than the females. The children are definitely more affected than the adults. And if I look at these statistics, the 80 to 90% of all the children will experience the otitis media somewhere down the line before they have, before they grow up, before they end, before the school age. So otitis media, the decreased immunity, the genetic predispositions, the anatomical defects of the palate, the ciliary dysfunction, the allergies, the lack of breastfeeding, passive smoke exposure, obesity, high BMI, high fatty diet, vitamin D deficiency, use of nasogastric tubes, all this somewhere or the other bring about the excessive incidence of the otitis media with effusion. The mucins, now over here again, the issue that comes is genes which are there, the gene expression for the MUC5B gene, that again would be a part of the disease forming process, the etiopathogenesis which contributes. So if you see otitis media with effusion has so many predisposing factors, has so many factors which affect it, that it really becomes difficult at times to collaborate it. So what causes it? Basic thing is over here is eustachian tube dysfunction. Now eustachian tube, that poor little tube sitting at the back of the nasopharynx, traversing through a bony and the cartilages part, entering into the middle ear, looks so benign sort of a thing. But then that forms the, that holds the key to the disease of the middle ear as long as the tympanic membrane is intact. So whether I fly, whether I dive, whether I sneeze, whether I blow my nose, whether I have COVID, somewhere down the line, everybody puts the blame on the eustachian tube. The eustachian tube, what happens? The equilibrium of the pressure between the middle and the external ears is basically the job of the eustachian. When I talk about external air, it is the outer atmospheric pressure that which is balanced by the eustachian tube. The clearance of the secretions from the middle ear, they can be cleared through the eustachian tube, but then this works on a two-way process. I can also push in the secretions from the nasopharynx into the middle ear by a negative pressure. Then the protection of the middle ear is again a job of the eustachian tube. But this dysfunction of this tube is what causes the problem what we are dealing with today. So eustachian tube malfunction could cause otitis media with effusion, an incomplete resolution of an acute otitis media, allergy. You know, when we were doing pharmacology, tell me the side effects of drug X, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, death. Tell me the side effects of drug Y, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, death. Tell me the causes of this particular disease, congenital, inflammatory, neoplastic, traumatic. So you cover up everything. And one poor chap in majority of the diseases comes across is allergy. So we blame allergy for so many things, including otitis media with effusion. So eustachian tube malfunction, incomplete resolution of acute otitis media, allergic issues, the predominance of streptococcus pneumoniae, Haemophilus influenza, Murex cellulae catarrhalis, and the strep pyogenes, the other ones which could go into the thing as for to cause acute otitis media leading to an unresolved situation which ultimately ends up in a otitis media with effusion. Whether it is adenoid hyperplasia, whether it is chronic tonsillitis, chronic sinusitis, cleft palate, palatal palsy, tumors of the nasopharynx, all of them somewhere down the line would contribute to otitis media with effusion. So how does it work? If I look at this cycle over here, if I take the first cycle over here, we have the presence of upper respiratory infection. Now this would lead to inflammation edema due to the constricted space with results to venous and the lymphatic stasis. Now that causes an edema over there, which leads to a decrease in ventilation, which leads to an increase in the negative pressure, which leads to mucosal secretions coming out into the middle ear. And that is what leads to otitis media with effusion. So URI, inflammation, decrease in ventilation, negative pressure, mucosal secretions, otitis media with effusion. On the other hand, same type, we could have the eustachian tube dysfunction, absorption of the oxygen occurs inside the middle ear and the nitrogen, negative pressure in the middle ear, transudate from the mucosa, leading to otitis media with effusion. So these two principles, basically, if I look at it, are the ones which contribute to the otitis media with effusion, and majority and most of the things lies in this critical area, which is the nasopharynx. So now if I look at the further contributions, apart from what we have talked, reflux. Now, this is another fashionable thing today, gastroesophageal reflux disease, because with the changing diagnostic features, the reflux activity which goes from the stomach through the esophagus into the nasopharynx, that could be a precursor to the otitis media with effusion. Why it is there? They found certain gastrins inside the middle ear, the gastric secretions, the enzyme from the gastric secretion they found in the middle ear. That led to the belief that yes, it could happen. The reflux also could cause an inflammation in the nasopharynx in the region of the eustachian tube. That could lead to otitis media with effusion. Reaction to the bacteria which are already present, that could be a precipitating factor for release of fluids over there. Pepsin A has been found in the middle ear, which again indicates that it could have come from the stomach, reflux again. Inflammatory mediators. Now, these are the ones which could lead to the mucin-rich effusion, because the upregulation of the mucin is the one with the gene which is the one which could cause effusion. And another thing which is there is biofilms. Now biofilms are again important things. They were very important, then they became less important. Now again they are gaining significance. They form a very thick barrier sort of a thing, a layer sort of a thing in which the bacteria harbors itself. The whatever medicines you give make them difficult to penetrate. And therefore, this situation, the bacteria still be over there, leading to the problems, whether it is otitis media, secretory, or it is even CSOM, this makes a difference. So, if we again come down, the edema around the eustachian tube, the inflammatory cytokines, they attract plasma cells, leukocytes, macrophages, the epithelium over that region changes to the pseudostratified or the columnar, or the cuboidal epithelium. There is hyperplasia, which leads to increased goblet cell cells over there, which lead to an increase in the secretion. So the critical area again is the nose and the nasopharynx over here. then comes the palatal issue. If I have a cleft palate, if I have palatal movement restriction, if I have palatal palsy, now that would lead to incompetence in my nasopharynx, that would lead to hypertrophy of the lymphoid tissue in the nasopharynx, that would lead to inflammation, swelling in the nasopharynx, and that would again lead to otitis media. So improper palatal movement, improper opening of the eustachian tube, eustachian tube malfunction, which could happen over there. Then nasopharyngeal issues. Now, this is a problem in adults, which is something which always must ring your bell. Unilateral otitis media with effusion in an adult must start the bells ringing very loud and very clear, because we need to look into the nasopharynx as to what exactly the cause is. Because unilateral otitis media in adult, one must think the possibility of malignancy or a nasopharyngeal tumor. Incomplete resolution of acute suppurative otitis media. You know, the persistent inflammatory activity in the middle ear, the mucosal stimulation, the secretion of the sterile fluid in the middle ear would lead to otitis media with effusion. The allergy would cause mucosal edemas, increase in the secretions, obstruct of the eustachian tube opening, and finally effusion. So this is how the fluid into the middle ear can get collected. The clinical features. Now, the acute versus the chronic. If I just to differentiate between the otitis media with effusion, if I look at the acute otitis media, I would be having a feeling of blocked ear, decreased hearing associated with acute nasal infection, especially viral. I could have fever, I could have very severe pain, I could have discharge from the ear. But when I talk about otitis media with effusion, I'm looking at children with the school going age, they have hearing loss, a mild earache or a sensation of heaviness in the ears. Next 2 points which I'm going to talk is, which is important. We do not recognize the problem at times as an ENT surgeon. We do not lay more importance onto this problem of otitis media with effusion, because the heaviness in the hearing or the decrease in the hearing which happens, if I neglect that, that could lead to scholastic development issue, that could lead to my improper speech development issue, that could lead to my poor academic performance issues. And that is something which I really need to look into and diagnose, because it leads to some other amount of morbidity and developmental issues which come. So clinical features, the physical sufferings which are there, which could be disability issues which are coming across with otitis media with effusion, the physical suffering, the emotional distress, the caregiver's concern. Imagine a mother's, because when the child cannot listen to the softly spoken words, or even at times even the conversational speech, it really does give a concern to the mother, because the child's upbringing in the school and in the family also takes a backseat. The sequelae would include the tympanic membrane retraction, ossicular erosion, maybe a clerestomia formation, tympanic membrane perforation. So they compound the problem as time advances if they are not recognized and if they are not looked into. So children with comorbidities such as Down syndrome, cleft palate are also the ones who are more affected. So due to this, there are developmental delays which could happen. It could lead to a disability in the child. It could lead to a psychological setback in the child, which could be educational and social both. And at the end of the day, perceptual, linguistic, cognitive, educational, and emotional issues could be precipitated by not diagnosing the secretory otitis media. So what do I do? The diagnosis is based upon my otoscopy. This is the most important thing to do, because that is what is going to diagnose it. If I look in, I have to differentiate between the acute otitis media, which is a red, congested, bulging tympanic membrane from the fluid-filled tympanic membrane. You can see the air bubbles over here inside. You can see the fluid over here. It's a dull, bulging tympanic membrane versus in an acute, where you have a perforation with a pending perforation or a big bulging tympanic membrane over there. So the differentiation between acute otitis media and secretory otitis media or otitis media with effusion must be done with care. What do I do? I normally may not be needing any investigations. A simple, but in case at times I need to look at the investigations, the pure tone audiometry, which would reveal a conductive hearing loss, is adequate enough for me to again compound my diagnosis along with that. Now, this is a chart which I want you to see. What happens is, if you see this as my hearing, now 0 to 20 would be, which is the one which is seen in green, is normal. But the secretory otitis media, the otitis media with effusion, if you see the figures on the left-hand side screen, the hearing loss with the ear fluid which happens ranges between 0 to 55 decibels, but an average of 28. So 25 decibel approximately is the average hearing loss which a child may have in a otitis media with effusion. Now, what does that speech band indicate? 21 to 40 is mild hearing loss. 41 to 60 is moderate hearing loss. So if I look at up to 55, the child could have a moderate hearing loss, which would have a problem in his normal speech perception. And an average individual, now Mark, we said that 50% of kids are going to have it before they go to school. So when they have it before going to school, at an average hearing loss of 28.5 decibels, the area which is involved is soft speech perception. So a child may not have perception for a soft speech while you are talking, may not at times even have a perception for a normal speech. And when he goes to school, this is what makes the difference between his scholastic activities. So one has to be very careful in diagnosing it and appreciating the child's problem. If the mother says my child is not hearing, it's high time we start definitely looking at with the child's problem. Impedance audiometry is again may help me in aiding my diagnosis. I could have a B-type tympanogram. Radiological investigations not done very commonly. We don't require it, but in case we suspect a complication has occurred at the end of the day because of non-detection and other issues settling in. But when we have to look at otitis media with effusion in an adult, we must get the radiological evaluation, CT scan and MRI to look at the nasopharynx and see if I'm not missing out anything over there. Because this is something which I think if an ENT surgeon, I can catch hold of one individual in my lifetime who has a CA nasopharynx with otitis media with effusion, unilateral, I think my purpose as an ENT surgeon is served. But if I miss out one patient, I would definitely feel very bad at the end of the day. Diagnostic tympanosynthesis, when we have tympanosynthesis, what we do, we normally don't do it too often now, but otherwise when we were doing our residency, it was a procedure in the OPD. We used to just sit, put in a needle inside, get the fluid out and have a confirmed diagnosis over there. The treatment part, when we look at the treatment of otitis media with effusion, medical management is the key step. So where I use systemic decongestants, I use local decongestants, anti-allergics, antibodies, Valsalva's maneuver, carboxymethylcysteine, steroids, all these form a list of the medicines which can be used, but whether they should be used or not is a matter of debate. Local decongestants to clear out the area of the eustachian tube, done, point taken. The only thing is, let us not end up in rhinitis medicamentosa by giving the medicine for too long. Anti-allergics, even though allergy is a cause for it, how much does anti-allergic help in managing the otitis media with effusion once it has happened is a debatable thing. Antibiotics, yes. The antibiotics, because they have isolated the bacteria from the middle ear while they have been in the parasynthesis, and the same bacteria, the ones which are left after the acute otitis media episode. So at times we may have to give long-term antibiotics to the individual. That's something which is a very debatable and interesting topic to look at. Valsalva's maneuver is again an interesting maneuver, but then when I'm doing the Valsalva's maneuver, at times I may push the nasopharyngeal infection into my middle ear, leading a sterile situation to end up in a infective situation. So converting an otitis media with effusion, which is a sterile thing, into an acute otitis media because of the pushing it through the to the eustachian tube. Mucolytic agents like carboxymethylcysteine have been used. How much they are useful is again a very debatable issue. So I would not comment upon that. Use of steroids, again, easier said than done. If you look at the steroids, okay, fine, inflammatory agent, and a lot of people use steroids, but whether they're ethical or not to be used in this thing, again, a very debatable issue. But use of local decongestants for a short while, use of antibiotics, systemic decongestant could be a part of the armamentarium. The surgical treatment is, again, I come back to my balloon, take a needle over there, try to puncture the balloon, so you are getting the fluid out, and that is what the treatment of the meningotomy is. So meningotomy, if I look at it, piercing the external artery, traversing the external artery canal, making a small opening in the tympanic membrane, just puncturing the tympanic membrane, let the fluid out. At times the fluid is thick, you may not be able to get it out. So that's the time when you need to put a beer can principle, make another opening, counter opening to get the fluid out. do the suction. At the end of it, you might have to, you just put in a tympanostomy tube, a Grome over there to help it out. So the of the for the cause and both the effect, meningotomy for the diagnosis, get the fluid out, and a Grome insertion inside to balance the pressures, because your eustachian tube is closed, so I need to balance the pressure in the middle ear. So I open the middle ear directly outside through the external canal by the use of a Grome. But that's not all. It's not just managing the fluid. It's managing the root cause of it, the underlying cause for it. So the adenoidectomy, tonsillectomy, a cleft palate repair, the nasopharyngeal tumor management, and allergy forms a part of the management of the otitis media with effusion. So a picture to see that we've done the puncture over here, we've done the meningotomy over here, we put in a Grome over here to manage the problem. If I don't handle it well, then what happens? I end up in creating the sequelae. What sequelae? I could have a disease of otitis media, which could lead to ankylosis of the ossicles. I could lead to a retraction pocket with a cholesteatoma. I could end up in tympanosclerosis. I could end up in ossicular erosions. All these issues can occur if I do not handle my otitis media with effusion, a relatively benign condition, which would turn out to be a condition with greater morbidity issues as the child develops. So a child who has had more episodes in the childhood is likely to continue with the episodes as he grows up. That is what has been seen. So my job is to manage the otitis media with effusion at an early time by diagnosing it and seeing that this it does not progress to the sequelae stage. One area which I think needs to be just mentioned a little bit is the aerotitis media, otitic barotrauma. That also ends up in the otitis media with effusion. All of us has flown in times when there is a bad weather, when the air pockets, we hit them hard, the aircraft goes up and down, we've dived in the swimming pool, gone down deep sea diving also for scuba diving. And this area, if we look at times we end up in acute otitis media with this barotrauma. Now what happens over there? There is normally the eustachian tube balances the pressure in the middle ear with the outside pressure, that is in the aircraft pressure. But when a sudden descent is happening, that is the time when the eustachian tube gets locked. So a pressure which goes a differential between 90 millimeters of mercury, the eustachian tube collapses over there, and that leads to a sucking in of the soft tissues of the eustachian tube itself into the lumen, leading to the blocking of the eustachian tube. Now that process is known as locking of the eustachian tube. Once it gets locked up, then again the situation again comes over there. There's an inability to equalize the pressure. A sudden negative middle ear pressure happens. Vascular engorgement occurs. Transudation occurs. And once the transudation occurs, there's fluid collection inside, and it may also have hemorrhagic fluid. And you could end up in a looking at something like a blue drum inside. You could see the hemorrhage which has happened. The hemorrhagic effusion occurs inside the middle ear. So the acute condition is caused by a rapid change of atmospheric pressure, which could be also, like we have said, in a plane, deep sea driving, compression chamber. And basically here also again, it is the eustachian tube malfunction which causes the problem. So otitic barotrauma is something which we must be aware of. So what happens over here? The person may complain of severe pain in the ear, we may complain of hearing loss, tinnitus, giddiness. If you look at the eardrum, retraction, congestion, air bubbles, hemorrhagic effusion, hearing loss, conductive type, the treatment in this case would be decongestants, antibiotics, and a meningotomy. That would help to relieve the pressure inside, that would help to drain the fluid out, the hemorrhagic fluid out before it gets organized, and the person would have much better things. But prevention is better than cure, so prophylaxis is important. We should avoid air travel during upper respiratory tract episodes. The prophylactic nasal decongestants could be asked. The prophylactic Valsalvas could be asked to be done by the person as he flies. So the points as far as this is concerned, the otitis media diffusion is concerned, would be that it's a common preschool condition with new entrants of the school children. The frequently associated with conductive hearing loss, which may go up to 50 decibel, but an average of 25 decibel hearing loss could happen. It is a matter of concern because it is thought that it causes developmental issues of the child. Problems can happen. The otitis media could cause disabilities. There is a risk factor which includes male gender, low socioeconomic status, exposure to smoke, tobacco smoke, bottle feeding, attendance at daycare centers. Episodes appear to last more than 14 days, but there is normally a spontaneous resolution. Also, the treatment such as long antibiotics and prophylactic antibiotic therapy may improve the rate of resolution of otitis media in a short term only if I do only if I do a Gromme, if I do only adenoidectomy, if I do only meningotomy, it doesn't help too much. A combination of the two would need to be sorted out. The Gromes and adenoidectomy offer a modest improvement in hearing with an average improvement of up to 12 decibel hearing loss at 6 months and up to 6 decibel at 12 months. So that basically covers up our topic for the otitis media with effusion. An important topic which every person deals with, but the only problem is that the diagnosis must be done in time, at the correct time. You are faced with children who are also crying. When they are crying, their eardrum becomes red and congested. So you may be having a problem at times to diagnose acute otitis media or the otitis media with effusion. Now, coming down to the other part, the CSOM, the chronic suppurative otitis media, the mucosal disease. Now, if I look at the mucosal part, the mucosal disease, you know, if I have to define CSOM first, it is defined as a chronic infection of the middle-ear mucosa, which is lining the middle-ear cleft, with a perforation for duration of 2 to 6 weeks. 3 weeks average, but 2 to 6 weeks is the accepted norm, what is being referred to in very successful. And what is the middle-ear cleft? Middle-ear cleft includes the Eustachian tube, the middle-ear proper, the mastoidiacal system. That is the system which is involved in chronic suppurative otitis media, the mucosal disease. Now, what is the mucosal disease? If I look at CSOM, let me just talk about, rather than say chronic suppurative otitis media every time, we come down to the acronym of CSOM, much more popular than that. So CSOM can be simply divided into a mucosal disease and a cholestitoma or a squamosal disease. So if I look at this differentiation between the CSOM as a mucosal and a squamosal disease, if I look at mucosal disease, it is a chronic inflammation of the middle ear cleft, which is secondary to the perforation in the past tensa, the cause of which may be initially an infective or trauma insertion-like or traumatic. And any associated discharge from the perforation would now be termed as an active mucosal disease, and in a dry perforation, which is inactive mucosal disease at this point of time. So I have mucosal otitis media, chronic suppurative otitis media, active variety and the inactive variety. So just a simple thing, but this would be the new terminology. If I go by the traditional terminology, the mucosal disease would be acronymed to the similar thing of the tumor tympanic type or the SAFE type. So if I look at it that way, also known as a SAFE ear or the tumor tympanic disease, it does not cause. Why is it not caused? Because it does not cause any serious complications. The infection is limited to the anterior inferior part of the middle ear cleft and is associated with the perforation in the past tensa. So, sequence of events in the chronic suppurative otitis media, the clinical event, how did it happen? Again, the basic process, like we said, it's the same, it's one part of a large spectrum. So, there is an acute infection and inflammation. The mucosal ulceration happens. The mucosal ulceration leads to a further edema, infection and edema, a granulation and polyp could happen over here. Now, once the mucosal ulceration is happening, this is a time when my perforation can happen. So once a perforation happens, if it heals, well and good. If it does not heal, it ends up in a permanent perforation or a long-term perforation as a chronic suppurative otitis media, which may be ending up in either an active form or an inactive form as the time passes. So the individual will present with a chronic discharging ear in the absence of fever or much pain in the ear. So why is this disease safe? Because there is no risk for the bone erosion, which normally would happen. It is not known to cause intracranial complications. Discharge from the middle ear flows freely through the perforation and the past tensa, and usually the perforation of the past tensa is surrounded by a rim of intact tympanic membrane. The annulus is intact in all these cases. But the disease is safe compared to the squamosal part, squamosal type, which is the cholestitoma. So what is the What is the etiology? An inadequately treated acute suppurative otitis media, which has caused a permanent perforation, persistent perforation, or a permanent perforation syndrome, what is we call it as, at times the presence of a focal sepsis in the nose and the throat causing the infection over there. Infected traumatic central perforation could happen after the extrusion of a ventilation tube. We may end up in a permanent perforation. The repeated or continuous middle ear infections can end up in a perforation over there. So this would lead to a chronic suppurative otitis media, the mucosal type. One has to be careful because once the edges of the perforation get epithelized, the perforation tends not to heal, and therefore that ends up in a permanent perforation syndrome, which could lead, which ends up in the CSOM, which is the safe variety or the mucosal variety. Over a period of time, issues may develop. The, like we said, the ear is a contiguous cavity. The temporal bone is consists of so many intercommunicating channels that the infection in one part does not stay focused in one part, and the further issues of bony erosion may occur, leading to complications. So we need to again look at manage a mucosal type of a disease in time. So if I look at it, the disease process, again, dysfunction of the eustachian tube, chronic inflammation of the nose and pharynx, and dysfunction of the immune system is the one which can cause the problems. So in an unresolved middle ear infection, what happens? There's an uncomplicated inflammatory process of the middle ear, which may evolve over time to produce persistent effusion and irreversible mucosal change. Once that happens, the fluid which is there will contain enzymes to alter the mucosal lining of the middle ear. It results in a collapse and a chronic perforation. That is how the perforation happens. There is erosion of the epithelium over there. The fluid, the enzymes over the mucosal lining. The mucosal lining changes its character, which results in a collapse or a chronic perforation, and the obstruction of the narrow communication passages in the nose, in the ear, leads to the obstruction. The mucosal folds get sucked out, and therefore the problem continues. So if I look at the microbiology compared to the Murex salae, etc. over here, we have a slight difference in the bacterial picture over here. Maybe Pseudomonas, maybe E. coli, maybe Proteus, Staph aureus, and the anaerobes are the ones which take part over here. These organisms are commonly not found in the respiratory tract, but they have come from outside because the perforation is there. Now, whether it has come through the nasopharynx, from outside into the nasopharynx into the middle ear, or through the perforated eardrum from outside into the middle ear. These organisms are commonly found on the skin of the external otic canal. The gram-negative bacilli have also been isolated. Now, pathology. How does it happen actually? The middle ear mucosa, if you see, is lined by secretory epithelium. Now that forms the gland-like structures over there. So the ossicular erosion happens. It is mainly due to the osteoclastic bone resorption that happens, the granulation tissue that makes its appearance over there, the avascular necrosis which happens in the bone because of the vascular supply of the bone, and that leads to the bony erosion, the ossicular erosion which can happen. Then the again, the next highlight over here is the tympanosclerosis or the hyalinization. Now, this is a healing response due to the hyalinization of the collagen and the calcium and phosphate deposits over there. And this results from the specific autoimmune reaction which happens, which results in the hearing loss and ossicular mobility restriction. To the pathophysiological process, I'll just go through the cascade. CSOM is initiated by the episode of acute infection, the irritation and the inflammation of the middle ear mucosa occurs, the mucosal edema happens, the mucosal ulceration and the epithelial lining breakdown and a perforation happens. This is what the CSOM mucosal type is developing over here. The mucosal ulceration has happened, the mucosal edema has happened, the irritation of the middle ear mucosa has happened, and the middle ear mucosa has been infected. Now, once the perforation is there, then after that, maybe the granulation tissue develops, or maybe the mucous membrane develops into a polyp. The same situation, inflammation, ulceration, infection, granulation, bony destruction, and complications could spread. So it starts with the inflammation and at times may end up in a bony destruction in case it is not managed or in case the infection goes. But the basic cascade occurs is because of the, what we have told, the erosion which happens because of the mucosal edema and the ulceration which happens. And it has been seen that over here, we have a cellular immunity which plays a role. So just to make a list of the inflammatory mediators which could happen, the nitric oxide, the reactive oxygen species. So all these things could have an effect on the middle ear environment which is there, And the other thing which can happen over here is the findings of the, again over here, the biofilm can play a role, the increased interleukin 8 factors, the increased transcript of proteins, the temporal bone erosion, the ossicular chain disruption, all these are the pathophysiological findings which can end up in the disease process being presented. So what are the risk factors? Multiple episodes of acute otitis media, crowded rooms, crowded conditions, large family, daycare, craniofacial abnormalities increase the risk, the passive smoking, breastfeeding, socioeconomic status, all these are a part of the risk factor which predominate the precipitation of the mucosal disease of the CSOM. The clinical features, basically discharge is profuse and mucopurulent, it is not foul smelling, since the infected area is open at both ends, discharge doesn't accumulate, ossicular chain is mostly uninvolved, like we said, over a period of time, it could get involved. The patients have a conductive hearing loss, moderate conductive hearing loss, 30 to 40 decibels. The pain is usually due to the otitis externa and not due to the disease itself. Whenever we have in the presence of a mucosal disease, if we have fever, vertigo, pain, it should raise concerns about the intratemporal or the intracranial complex. So we must need to look at it, have we missed out something over there. The history of a persistent suppurative otitis media after appropriate medical treatment should alert the physician. Am I missing out a cholesteatoma? Let me look at it more carefully. So what type of tympanic membrane perforations could be there? The wide variety of tympanic membrane perforations could be seen, and including the mucosal hypertrophy, maybe a dry perforation, maybe inactive disease, maybe an active disease. So it would depend upon what stage you are going to see that. So the stages of the tubotympanic disease, if I look at it, it could be an acute stage to start with, the inactive stage, a quiescent stage, and a healed stage. So when I look at acute stage, we have a mucopurulent, non-foul smelling discharge, hypertrophic mucosa, and this is what the discharge would come out. Inactive stage, at this point of time, the disease is a dry perforation in the pars tensa, the annulus is intact, there's a healthy mucosa over here. A quiescent stage, it's a dry perforation, normal or hypertrophic mucosa, with no discharge since the last few days. And so it has been a quiescent stage at this point of time. And then comes the healed stage, where we have the various forms of tympanic membrane, which you can see over here. I can have tympanosclerosis, I can have ossicular degeneration, necrosis over here. The whole tympanic membrane goes and adheres back. So it is healed up, but then I've not managed it in time with the proper management. And therefore, once it is healing up, the problem occurs. What investigation need to be done? Tuning fork test, flow tonometry, radiological evaluation. Now, it would normally show a conductive hearing loss between 30 to 40 decibels. If it exceeds more than 60 decibels, then ossicular chain disruption should be suspected. I could have a sensorineural hearing loss, which we'll just come to in a minute, when I should have a sensorineural hearing loss. Management, oral toilet, inactive stage, suction clearance, syringing with mild acetic acid solution, topical antibiotics, ear drops, by displacement methods. Now, the issue of management is a bit complex because there are many factors which play a role over here. Namely, the viscosity of the drug, of the drops. Normally, the drops which are there available, the antibiotic drops which are available, are very watery. The problem with the watery discharge is it is dispersed all through the spaces, but then it remains in contact for a much shorter period. So if we increase the viscosity of the drops which are there, that point of time, our drops may not be in touch with every part, may not penetrate every part of the middle ear, but then it does cause a longer area of contact, duration of contact, and therefore more effective. pH of the drops, normally pH is kept at an acidic part, more on the acidic side. This causes a little bit of a problem because our external aortic canal is okay, but our middle ear is a neutral pH, and an acidic drops over there could end up in a more worse situation at times. Therefore, we need to balance the pH of the drops. Use of steroids, yes, it does help to reduce the inflammation. It does help to reduce the granulations, it helps to reduce the polypoidal mucosa over here, and therefore the spacing and the middle ear spaces become more clearer. Bacterial resistance to local drops is a more hyperinflated thing. Normally we do not have bacterial resistance, and it is more to the systemic medicines, but not to a bacterial resistance, not to a local drops. But in case you are saying that drops are not effective, most likely the delivery of the drops has not been in the correct manner. So technique of instillation has to be important. Every surgeon must know and must tell the individual how to put the drops, that when you put the drops, do not put a cotton inside, otherwise drops get soaked up in that. After putting the drops, one must press the triggers so that the placement method and the drops go inside, and only then it would have its effect. Granulation tissue control is very important, because once the granulation tissues are there, the eustachian tube is blocked. I mean, so many other areas get blocked because of that, and the granulations do not let the normal mucosa regenerate. So the use of steroids over here to cut down the granulation tissue is important. Systemic versus topical medication. Topical medication is way far ahead rather than systemic medication. Systemic medications only in case it is an uncontrolled or a systemic problem or a complication has occurred. Only then systemic medicine will play a role. Otherwise, topical medicines are more than enough. The use of nasal sprays and drops. Okay, fine. You say the eustachian tube opens up with then, but over here the middle ear is exposed to the outer ear. And if we keep on using the nasal drops too often, rhinitis medicamentosa takes its toll over there. And no drops are going to have its effect as long as there is pus inside the mid ear. So you have to clear the pus. Oral toilet must be done in the proper manner. Only then it is going to have its effect. Otherwise, once the GABA is there, most of the medicines, the pus contains GABA, and most of the medicines will not have its effect on the local mucous membrane or the bacteria over there. A word about non-responders to treatment protocols. Now, we have seen that quite a few times we keep on giving full wholehearted management, but yet the mucosal disease fails to respond. Now, these are some of the issues which are dogging us. So we must rule out hidden or undiagnosed or missed cholesteatoma. Are we looking at something like that? The role of autoendoscopy comes into the picture over here. Tuberculosis of the ear. Now, this again, tuberculosis of the middle ear mucosa is again important in our country. One must think about the possibility of a tuberculosis. The gene expert test in this case at times does not yield a positive test result. So one has to have a clinical judgment. The other ancillary issues must be looked at and think in terms of tuberculosis. Gastroesophageal reflux disease, as long as that is keeping on working, the middle ear may not heal up properly. Neurological and anatomical issues are there. If my palatal palsy is there, my other things are there. So my normal ventilation of the middle ear is affected, and therefore the management will not happen properly. Iatrogenic trauma history. I must take the history of iatrogenic trauma which has happened, because that could also lead to a non-responding treatment. Another issue is the eosinophilic separative otitis media. Now this is associated with asthma, with allergic rhinitis, and also with the sensorineural hearing loss, and has a highly viscous yellow fluid discharge. It would not be manageable by the antibiotic drops. Therefore, it becomes one of the part of the non-responders treatment protocol. And over here, the anti-steroids are the ones which are the mainstay. And failure to address the focus of the problem to handle that is again a part of the non-responder protocol. Surgical management, the surgery should be considered if CSOM fails to respond to a combination of topical and systemic therapy, surgery towards eradication of the focal sepsis, surgery aimed towards eradication of the middle ear disease, and surgery aimed to reconstruct in the form of laryngoplasty or a tympanoplasty. I'm not going to go into the surgical procedures because Dr. Sameer has said that they're going to cover surgical procedures as a separate procedure. So I come to the end of it, but before I wind up, I wish to say a few thank yous. I wish to thank all the participants for today's webinar. I wish to say thank you to the AOI for taking up this initiative to start this series. I thank Dr. Sameer Bhargav, Dr. Bharti, Kaushal, Yogesh Dabholkar, and the moderators, Dr. Nandu and Dr. Sambhaji, for letting me be on this platform and talk for 45 minutes nonstop. I thank you to the prevailing COVID condition, so are opening us so many more avenues for the teaching learning avenues. I also thank Dr. Reddy's labs for facilitating and coordinating this session. Thank you so much. Any questions, I would be most happy to answer. Nandu.
Sir, thank you so much for an excellent presentation, for your twin presentations. Sir, there are many questions that have been bombarded. First question is from Dr. Ranjan Nath. How to, from Guwahati, how to access ET dysfunction?
How to access?
How to access eustachian tube dysfunction?
Well, you know, eustachian tube function, the traditional methods of evaluating the eustachian tube function are still the best. Between you and me, if I actually, in an intact tympanic membrane, eustachian tube functions, we really do not have to do separate functions for the eustachian tube. Simple tests of impedance is enough to help me guide the middle ear and the eustachian tube function over there. So I don't have to do specific tests for the eustachian tube functions in a secretory otitis media or a chronic separate otitis media.
Okay, sir. Second question is from Dr. Shama from Kannur. Antibiotic and steroid for how long in OME?
Again, the role of antibiotics in OME is a very important role because of the presence of the bacteria which have been isolated over there. Now, whether when to start the antibiotics rather than how long to give the antibiotics is the question. Bilateral otitis media with effusion or a child having at least 3 attacks, I must put the child on antibiotics. Over here, the antibiotics can be given for 3 weeks, and a low dose antibiotic can be given for 3 weeks in the form of cephalosporins or in the form of amoxiclav, which can be given without a problem. Use of steroids, systemic steroids, I would not recommend it use in simple otitis media with effusion in the children, but it would all depend upon my clinical judgment whether I have to use or not. But steroids, for, I would tend to avoid steroids because it has also been said that it would not serve any purpose. It should be, one should be dissuaded from using steroids in a case of otitis media with effusion. Antibiotics, yes.
Okay. And in adults, sir, is there any use of steroids in adults?
No, not really. There's, for otitis media with effusion, what do I achieve by using steroids? I would not achieve, as for an anti-inflammation, yes. But then my local decongestant would equally help me in that. So steroid, I would not actually use steroids in otitis media with effusion.
And second question is from Dr. Samir Thakre. That according to your presentation, you won't use any impedance test in the first visit. But when patient comes for follow-up, do you use impedance test to judge whether that otitis media with effusion has cleared or not?
See, the effusion would take a long time to clear. At times, if you are going to treat the otitis media with effusion, the fluid inside would remain for almost 6 weeks at times. So a clinical judgment is very easy to do over there. For documentation purposes, impedance audiometry can be done, but it is not going to help in my diagnosis because I've already made my diagnosis over there.
And Dr. Royal sir is asking a question from Aurangabad, sir. With the course of antibiotic, the secretion in SOM becomes the more thicker. Opinion of the sir is required for that.
So, like I said, a single line of management would not be too recommended. So a meningotomy, groma insertion, antibiotic, decongestant. So you would have to look at what combination of factors are you going to do, along with maybe the use of the adenoidectomy which needs to be done. Any single modality treatment is not going to help. A single meningotomy is going to close down. It is not going to help you. Just an adenoidectomy is again not going to help you. Adenoidectomy with a groma is going to help you. So you have to look at it from that viewpoint. Giving an antibiotic is converting a fluid into a sterile fluid. That's all. It's not going to increase the thickness of this thing. It is going to convert it into a sterile fluid. And it would drain out once the function has been established. It would drain out through the eustachian tube. If I've done a meningotomy, it will drain out through that area.
Okay.
The next question is from Dr. AP Shah from Patna. Is there any role of autonomic nervous system in development of OME?
I don't know.
Okay. So next question is from Devendra Maure. Is there any role of eustachian tube catheterization?
Not today. Because, you know, it's a procedure which is a dicey procedure. You need to first identify the eustachian tube. I might cause trauma to the eustachian tube. So, tumhine dard diya hai, tumhine dawa nahi de paoge uske baad. Because once you try to catheterize the eustachian tube, if you've not done it correctly, you're going to end up in a bigger problem. An endoscopic approach, they've tried out now the endoscopic catheterization of the eustachian tube. that's perfectly fine. You can push in air through that. But a catheter is on the eustachian tube. I would not recommend it at this point of time.
Sir, next question is from Jayanta Kumar Nath from Kolkata. When do you decide for surgical intervention in OME?
When do you decide? When you decide it when the fluid is, when it is not resolving and you think the fluid is thick, go ahead and do the incision, meningotomy. Actually, you know, in the West, meningotomy is the second most performed surgical procedure in childhood. When we were doing a residency in the OPD itself, we were carrying a disposable meningotome and doing it over there only. So I think it's a procedure which is underdone, and we need to diagnose the thing and manage it much more effectively, much more actively.
Yes, sir. There are bombardment of questions. So,
no problems.
There is next question is from Guwahati from Dr. Shambhunath Mukherjee. Use of clarithromycin in OME and biofilm around grommet.
And?
Biofilm around grommet.
See, again, these are biofilm, this thing, grommet, all are fancy things. What you need to do is just establish a drainage and establish a aeration over there. That's it. That's all what you need. You know, it's something like the cardiac person would start to give medicated stent and all that thing. But ultimately, what is the purpose of a stent? It is to maintain the canal of the thing over there. So once I've used a grommet, it's going to be there for 3-6 weeks. After that, I'm going to get it out. Why do I need biofilms over there? The use of antibiotics, clarithromycin, okay, fine. The first line of action would either be a macrolide or a cephalosporin or an amoxicillin. These would be my preferred medications.
Sir, any role of autonomic and system in development of otitis media effusion, sir?
I don't know.
I also do not know what is this meaning, autonomic and system in development of otitis media effusion.
Unless I'm looking at something like a vasomotor rhinitis, or if I'm looking at the imbalance between the autonomic nervous system, that could be causing my mucosa venous congestion over there, or the lymphatic congestion over there. Otherwise, I do not know. I would not be able to comment upon that. If anyone, Dr. Bharti or Samir, can comment upon it, I would be most happy with that. Meri knowledge bhi badhegi.
Yes, sir. It is a new question, sir. What exactly it meaning to the otitis media with the equation? Autonomic and
so there is new question from Dr. Shama from Kannur. When do you think about nasal spray in OME?
When do I use my nasal spray? What nasal spray? Am I looking at oximetazoline, xylometazoline, or am I looking at intranasal steroids? You see, again, if I'm looking at intranasal steroids, I'm trying to manage my allergic rhinitis over there, which could form a part of the otitis media with effusion. And the intranasal steroid spray would form the mainstay of my management for allergic rhinitis. So once I deal with that, my eustachian tube area gets aerated and I would sort out the problems. So, but use of the intranasal steroids spray in children, I would desist unless I have a clear-cut indication over there. Using the xylometazoline or oxymetazoline sprays, okay, fine, they are much better to be used than drops in a micronized form because they would lead to the area where I want them to reach. The question that comes over here is whether I'm using sprays or I'm using drops. Is the delivery part of the drops in the correct place? So how I instill my nasal drops is important. Just putting the nasal drops like this is not going to serve any purpose. It's just going to moisten out the bilateral and the medial nasal walls. So I need to tell the patient to lie down, hang your head below the level of the bed, put 2-3 drops, be in that position for a couple of minutes, then you move around because that is the time it would take for the drops to reach the eustachian tube opening. My intention is to clear out only the eustachian tube area opening. Just putting a drop or a spray without in the proper manner is not going to serve any purpose. How to use a spray is again important. What position I'm going to use a spray? Put my head down, put the nozzle up and then grow because it has to go along the direction of the nasal cavity. It's not just a fancy thing. If I do it in the correct manner like this, sitting up, it's just going to hit my roof of the nose and that's it. It's not going to serve any purpose. So whether I'm going to put the ear drops or I'm going to give the nasal drops or I'm going to put the nasal sprays, the methodology and technique of putting it must be known to everybody and must be explained to the student, to the patient.
Yes, sir. Another question is from Dr. Dhanna Rajan from Trivandrum. Does COVID-19 predispose to SOM?
No, that would be a very difficult question to answer. COVID is all mysterious to everybody, but they have found out the evidence of COVID virus in the middle ear effusions. And but now it's become more of a fashion that blame COVID for everything. I think only one thing COVID has not been able to take up is that without any relationship, COVID has caused pregnancy. That is the only area, I think, which is left untouched. Otherwise, COVID has caused every possible thing that is there today.
Yes, sir. Now, moving to your next talk about mucosal disease. Dr. Ramesh Roival from Aurangabad is asking whether eardrops are contraindicated if there is a perforation in tympanic membrane.
No, they are not contraindicated. They are indicated because... But the only thing is how you're going to put the eardrops is important. They're not it. And the correct antibiotic, if you're going to give it, perfectly fine. Give it. Go ahead and give it. No problems.
And the next question from Dr. Devendra Mahore from Nagpur. If persistent discharge, even after appropriate antibiotic, after culture and sensitivity test, what is your magic formula? Do you still go ahead with the surgery?
See, my first formula, I am not a magician, Devendra, but then... My magic formula is very simple. First thing is clean the ear properly. Till I do the oral toilet, till I do the suction clearance, till I do the dry mopping, wet mopping, no amount of antibiotics. I give 10 kg of antibiotics per day. It is not going to have any effect. So I need to clean the ear, get the mucosa exposed over there, then put the drops in the correct manner. Again, the culture sensitivity is a very misleading thing. The in vitro in vivo studies would give different results. I may not get the drops which I am going to give, the local, like I said, the local drops do not have a resistance. The culture sensitivity studies are more important when I'm going to give the systemic or the oral antibiotics. So over here, majority of the things should clear off if my management is correct. I've done the proper cleaning of the ear. That is something which is most important and which I can be very confident of saying almost 60% of people neglect it. Am I right, Samir?
Yes, absolutely, sir.
How many times in a week you do this ear cleaning by acetic acid?
Yeah, Nandu, you know, last 3 months, 4 months, I have not done any ear cleaning. I'm really missing my OPD days. I'm really missing handling the patient. And I'm getting withdrawal symptoms by now. But having said that, during the non-COVID period, to be very honest, with acetic acid, these days we are not cleaning. During my residency days, yes, we used to do a lot of irrigation with vinegar, with mild acetic acid, and they really used to work wonders. You know, a lot of medicines, we mentioned ethanol and glycerin just now, vinegar and acetic acid, gentian violet, mercurochrome, they were very effective things, but then so many things have changed over a period of time, and that's what makes you look old. But irrigation with vinegar, we've really not done too much nowadays.
The last question from Dr. Samir Thakre from Nagpur. In small central perforation, do you advocate dilute TCA cauterization?
If a very small 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter perforation, less trichloroacetic acid can be tried. A paper patch test can be done, or a simple drawing. Just you can, you know, another trick is take the Jobson Horn probe, the serrated edge, just clean it properly and just rotate it around the perforation, small 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter round perforation. It sort of freshens the edge. And that works out equally well. At times, you see the whole thing has healed up very well. But it will heal up only if the middle ear mucosa is ciliated and says a normal middle ear mucosa over there, and you've done a proper job in cleaning the ear. Then it will definitely heal. Traumatic perforations, even big ones, will heal much better without any management also.
Yes, sir. That's all, sir. Thank you so much for your all answering all questions.
I thank all the people who asked the questions because I was really scared in what is Nandu going to ask me. And mujhe dar lag raha tha.
But in your inimitable style, you answered that, and we love to listen to you and the effervescence that you bring whenever you are giving a talk. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Samir. Thank you so much. And this initiative for you, Bharti, everybody, the whole of the OI, I think, has done very well. And both my chairpersons, both the moderators today have really done a very good job today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Gulati sir. Thank you. Nice to meet you, sir, and listen to your talk, sir.
Thank you, Professor.
Okay, Anderson. Let's hope the COVID ends fast. In what they say in Russian language, Dasvidaniya, phir milenge. Let's meet sometimes in the near future.
Definitely. We met you at EOCON 2020 in Nagpur, sir.
I know I couldn't get the flight ticket. There were a lot of issues which I wrote at that time, last minute, because there was the flights were not working, the return flight in between.
Yes, sir.
And I had a meeting over here to reach back on that day. So I had apologized. Anji?
We'll catch you in EOCON 2022.
Yeah, sure. We'll be there.
Yeah. Thank you. the speakers of today, Professor Kapil and Professor Achal. Sir, we had a nice, excellent talk. And AOI, as it's striving hard to join hands with the government in the prevention of deafness, and the topics which we had are the they form the major chunk of preventable cause of deafness. So you gave very good points regarding the secretory otitis media and the chronic subretinal otitis media, mucosal type, Professor Samir also is like with the AOI is taking us, and then we are having talks and with Dr. Arun Agarwal and with Dr. Arshavardhan to join hands, and how effectively we can control the preventable causes, so that I think we need all your help in this aspect. I thank the speakers for today, and I thank the moderators who were with us and who did a wonderful job. I thank one and all. I thank Dr. Reddy's lab for their support in this venture of ours. Thank you, everyone. And I wish everyone a happy Ganesha festival, which is, I think, 2 days from now. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you very much.
Bye, Vimlesh.
Bye.
Vimlesh, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.